Hello students, so once we know the different categories of thermal materials, optical fiber and optical materials, so here we go with the last category in the other materials, that is the smart materials and the shape memory alloys. So there are a few applications where we need the materials to respond to the change of the environment. Say for example, if there is a change in the temperature, or if there is a change in the surrounding climate, say like a pressure, so it has to change its functionality. So there are materials which they have designed to respond to those changes also. So those materials we are going to call as the smart materials. So smart materials are the group of a new and state of the art material developed in recent times and which have a tremendous influence on many of the latest technologies. The word smart implies that these materials are able to sense changes in their environment and then respond to the changes in the predetermined manner. So these smart materials are also called as intelligent materials. Okay, so which are developed on the basis of newer and traditional materials. So when we see these smart materials are classified, are put in two categories. One is the piezoelectric materials, and one is the shape memory alloys. So when it comes to the piezoelectric material, so a few ceramic materials exhibit a distinct property where an applied stress induces an electric voltage. So we might have heard a few years back, the electricity was generated by the footsteps, which normally we are going to place it on the footpath. Okay, so means the stress induced was converted into electric voltage. So even the same thing is applied with the connecting of these footwear also. So where a stress induced on that one will make a contact and it will produce a electricity or a electric voltage. So these type of material are called as a piezoelectric behavior. So conversely, the reverse, the piezoelectric effect is the phenomenon whereby an applied voltage results in a dimensional changes across the material. So common among these materials which exhibit these piezoelectric property are barium titanate, lead titanate, lead zirconate and potassium niobate. So these piezoelectric materials normally used as a transducers between mechanical and electrical energies, used in a sonar applications where these underwater objects like submarines are detected and their positions are detected using ultrasonic emitting and receiving systems. So used wisely in the automotive sectors, in the wheel balancing, seat belt sensoring, keyless door entry, airbag sensors, etc. So used in a micro actuators for hard disks, inkjet printings, strain gauges, ultrasonic welders, smoke detectors, ultrasonic contact removal devices, etc. So wherever it comes to the sensing of changes in the environment and actuating some devices to respond to those changes, these piezoelectric materials plays an important role. So the second thing in the smart materials is the shape memory alloys. So as the name itself indicates, shape memory. So they are going to remember their shape. So the shape they are going to regain once there is a change in the operating temperature, or the load which is acting on that one, or the pressure which is going to act on these materials. So even after deformed, so there I have an ability to remember and return to their original shape and size. Okay, so upon a e-treatment. So maybe that is what we said, subjecting to a particular temperature. So deformation is normally carried out at a relatively low temperature, whereas shape memory effect happens due to heating. So once you say this is heated to a particular temperature, so once it is reached, so they will come back to their original shape or a state. So among these shape memory alloys, nickel titanium, that is in called as nitinol alloys, and some copper based alloys, okay, are the best suited for these shape memory alloys. So the first category in this one is a nitinol, which is an acronym for Nickel Titanium Naval Ordnance Laboratory. So this is named because so this was discovered by Bueller in 1997 at a Naval Ordnance Lab, USA. So hence the name is shortened to get a nitinol. So this is having a melting point of 1300 degrees Celsius and a density which is equal to 6.5 gram per centimeter cube. So the principle on which it is going to work on this one is we are going to see it in a pictorial and stepwise. So a shape memory alloy is a polymorphic, that is it may have a two crystal structures at a two different temperatures. So as we said, so when it is subjected to carrying out at a low temperature, so it may exhibit a separate or a different crystal structure, and when it is heated to a high temperature, then it exhibits a different crystal structure. That is what we call as polymorphic in nature. Okay, so these two different crystal structure we are going to observe at a two different temperatures. Okay. So the sequence how exactly the shape memory alloy effect is formed. So the first one is the austenitic phase present in a high temperature, so with a certain shape and size. So this is the initial shape, okay, so this rod like structure, and the crystal structure in that one will be like a austenite phase, okay, so which is a parent phase we call as, okay, which is present at a high temperature. So in the second one, so we'll see heavily twinned martensite phase at a low temperature, but with the same parent shape and a size. So this is how exactly we can see the transformed to martensite phase, okay, which is we are going to observe at a low temperature, which is deformed. So third one, deformed physical state, but with the martensite phase at a lower temperature. Okay, so this is the third stage where we can see a deformed physical state like this, okay, which is deformed physically, but inside that one, so there will be a martensitic phase which is going to present at a low temperature. So when the deformed material is heated, it transferred into the austenite and also simultaneously regains its parent shape and the size. So it was like this at a room temperature. So when it is heated again, so it will regain to its original shape, okay, like a straight pipe, okay, and with the austenitic phase. Say for example, so now we have a rod which is bent at a room temperature, which is having a deformed martensitic structure. So once it is heated to a particular temperature, so once it regains to austenitic, then automatically this bend will be removed, or this material will try to retain the rod like structure. Means automatically it, once the temperature is achieved, so it will regain to its original shape. Okay, the parent shape will be retained once we are going to have a at that temperature. So to fix the parent shape, okay, the test specimen must be held in a position and heated to austenitic temperature. This high temperature causes all atoms to arrange themselves into the most compact and regular pattern possible, resulting in a cubic crystal arrangement, which is nothing but the austenitic phase. Okay, so the one which we discussed in the stage one will be regained like this. Okay, so second one, on deforming, okay, at a low temperature, so we are going to observe a martensitic structure. Okay, so this is the one, so which is we are going to observe at a low temperature. Okay, so once the material is deformed physically, okay, we are going to have a bent like a structure. Okay, it is bent here, and we'll be having a martensitic phase which is retained in the stages. So once it is heated to a particular temperature, okay, so the physical state as well as the phase which is present in the material is regained. You can see the shape of that one will automatically change from bent like structure to the straight one, and inside that one the atoms will rearrange themselves in order to transfer the phase from martensitic to the austenitic. So on a heating, so that is how exactly we are going to see the shape memory changes. Okay, means so the shape which it had at that particular temperature, okay, will be regained even though it is deformed and operated at a low temperature. So once it is heated to that temperature, so it will automatically regains its parent shape as well as the phase which is present. So that is what is the shape memory alloys. And one more very important property, okay, normally a few materials exhibit is a super elasticity, or we call that one as a pseudo elasticity. So what is this phenomenon is, so this is the phenomenon where the parent shape in the austenitic phase transfer into martensite even without lowering the temperature. Okay, so as we discussed in the shape memory alloys, so to get a martensite, okay, we need to deform that and maintain a temperature which is lower than the austenitic condition. But here super elasticity means so without lowering the temperature, okay, so the austenite transfer to the martensite. So this can occur when parent phase is strongly loaded, which is enough to force the austenite into martensitic phase. Means so without altering the temperature, here by applying a mechanical load, okay, which is enough in order to transfer this austenite into martensite, so the shape of or the phase which is present in that one will transform. Okay, the alloy will not return to the austenitic phase until the loading is decreased, or only if there is a large amount change in the temperature. So as we seen in the shape memory alloys, the temperature should be increased in order to regain its original shape or original phase. So here, so once the load is applied, so the austenite will transfer to the martensite. So this martensite will remain until the load is removed, or until there is a considerable amount change in the temperature. Okay. So either one of the condition should be satisfied in order to regain its parent shape. Okay. So therefore, the austenite phase can be changed to martensite simply by strain rather than changing the temperature. So to change the temperature, it should be of a higher one. So by changing the strain, that is a load and a deformation, so one can easily change over the phases which are present in the material. The metal becomes pliable and can withstand a strain up to 8%. So this property of a shape memory alloys, so which undergo phase transformation without any temperature change, allows them to bear a large amount of stress without undergoing permanent deformation, is called as a super elasticity. Okay, so means even though without altering the temperature, okay, so by applying a mechanical load, that is making it to undergo the strain. Okay, so by controlling the strain rate, so one can easily control the behavior of the material or to regain its original shape. Okay, so next will be biological application of these shape memorials. So the first cardiovascular device developed with the SMA was the Siemens filter. Okay, this filter represents a new generation of devices that are used for blood vessel interruptions in order to prevent the pulmonary embolism. Okay, so these shape memorial alloys are used as a filters in a cardiovascular devices. So SMAs are used as a cathetes, retainers, clot filters, surgical anchors, bone plates, so intra-articulate balloon pumps, okay, laparoscopic tools, etc. during surgical procedures in human beings. So stents implemented in the arteries to improve blood flow can be made up of a SMA. So where they will change the shape and they will remove the blocks, okay, so which are present in the arteries. So SMAs have a large number of orthopedic application. Okay, for example, spinal vertebra spacer made from SMA inserted between two vertebrates. So it not only assures reinforcement, okay, so but also allows some degree of freedom in motion for the parent. Okay, several types of SMAs or orthopedic staples are used to accelerate the healing process of a bone fractures, exploiting the shape memory alloy effect, so which can be used for a further treatments. So plates made up of SMA are used as a cast when there are fractures in the facial areas, nose, jaws, etc. Okay, so these normally are made up in a normal thing. So when they go and fit into that position, so they will have a original shape like a curvature, okay, or an elongated one. Okay, so they are placed on a fracture and fixed with the screws, maintaining the original alignment of the bone and allowing cellular generation. Okay, so when these are heated, once it is fixed, when these are heated, so they try to recover the former shape, making a exact features which they need it in the human body. So other applications of a shape memory alloys. Okay, so reading glasses can be distorted while using. Okay, so if SMAs are used, they can bring back to the original shape. So SMA materials can be effectively employed in a beam column or column foundation bolted joints, which are weakest links in the structural during an earthquake. Okay, the breakage of the glasses, okay, so it can be minimized. Okay, SMAs may undergo massive plastic deformation due to earthquake energy and get back to original shape upon removal of the load. So SMA can be used in a many structural applications susceptible to the seismic activity. Okay, so flexible nanotall wires are used in a robotic arms. Nanotall wires are also used as actuators for a aeroplanes. Okay, so this can replace bulky hydraulic systems which are expensive and need of a lot of maintenance. So shape memorials are also used in anti-scalding devices and fire sprinklers, so where they sense and they can act according to the requirements. So means wherever there is a need to act according to the situation, okay, with the mechanical strain or a change in the temperature, so there one can easily think of adapting the shape memory alloys. So the materials, there is one class of material which normally we are going to use it in a implants in a human body. Okay, so the following properties which normally we look, okay, for that material whenever we are going to use implants in the human body. Strength of the implants material should be tested under tension, compression and shear, but higher compression strength is desirable than a tensile and a shear forces. So in general, fatigue limit of metallic implant should be approximately 50% of their ultimate tensile strength. So implant materials and design should account for the modification of a shape of a bone in a response to application of a forces. Okay, so ASTM, that is American Society for Testing of Materials, require a minimum of 8% ductility to minimize the brittle fracture of an implant material. So alloy should process outstanding biocompatibility when used in a implant. So they should not only light strong but also should be non-corrosive and retain their structural stability for a long time of a duration. Okay. So normally metallic implants are made up of titanium alloys, pure titanium, cobalt chromium alloys, stainless steels, okay, precious metals as gold, silver, platinum and palladium, so which are of non-corrosive in nature. So ceramic implants are bio-insert, inert, okay, ceramics made from aluminum, titanium, zirconium oxide and biodegradable materials such as Teflon, poly, urethane and Dacron are used as biomaterials, especially in heart valve replacements and blood vessels. And when it comes to the polymers, we can use for PTFE, PET, PMMA, UHMW, PP, PSF and PDS. Okay, so where poly, tetrafluoroethylene, polyethylene, tetraphthalate, okay, so all these materials are used for implants in the human body. Okay, so once we see all these categories, okay, so from the metals to the ceramics to the polymers, okay, and these shape memory alloys are advanced materials like smart materials and all. So one has to see, okay, while choosing the material, okay, so what are the condition or factors to be considered. Okay, so it is not something like only a property which we are going to look and we are going to select. Okay, so even when we are going to select a material, that should be compatible with the environment where we are going to use that one, okay, and the cost and the compatibility with the environment also. Okay, so again depends like a structures or a machines or a devices, so where we are going to use that one. So structures in a building, bridges, dams, towers, concrete roads, etc. So when we say machines, engines, lathe, turbine, generators, locomotives, motors, etc. Or when we say devices, robots, phones, laboratory equipment, measuring equipment, etc. Okay, so means so whichever the component we are going to use, okay, so depending upon that one, so one can choose the material. Say for example a service requirements, okay, like a mechanical property or a physical property or a electrical property or a chemical property or a thermal property or aesthetics. Okay, so all these property already we have seen from module number 1 and till now. Say like a strength, wear resistance, toughness, creep resistance, okay, or when it comes to the thermal property, specific heat, thermal conductivity, okay, refractoriness. So all these things means so if a material is chosen, okay, so one has to see these feasibility. Okay, so if it is a fabrication, so castability, forgeability, heat treatment, machinability, so whether that material can be welded, okay, or whether that machine material can be joined together, or is it heat treatable, okay, so and even the economic requirements. Okay, so even if a material satisfies all these service and fabrication requirement, so the cost is the one which normally or mainly we are going to decide. Okay, so for example, silver has a better electrical conductivity than a copper, but we can't go with the silver because it is a costlier, so copper is a preferred. Okay, so availability and the cost of the material, cost of the processing, etc. are the fundamental requirement, so which has to be fulfilled for any application in the competitive world. It is not only the fabrication or the properties which normally we look, it is the economic, okay, the cost of that one and the cost which we are going to incur for processing of that material matters a lot. So during the consideration of a material for a particular application. Okay, thank you.